Good morning, everyone, and I'm so thankful. I'm thankful for each one of you. I'm thankful for those who are listening online and by telephone. And I'm especially thankful for Miss Linda playing the piano.
Yes.
So it's the first time I've been able to sing during camp meeting and to sing because I'm not gifted enough to sing and play. I fumble too much. And to be able to sing with Leon beside me. So that's a real blessing, and I thank you for that. What I'll present this morning is an abridged version of an article in the recent Old Paths. And I'll be leaving out references and acknowledgments, acknowledgment of quotations for the most part to save time. We have to finish quickly to make room for the communion that will follow. But please know everything is referenced, all the quotations are there, and if you would like that data, I refer you to the paper. Also, for the sake of time, I'll not be using slides because it just will take too much time and there's so much that I want to share with you. Yesterday, I tried in a feeble way to share the beauty of God in giving us the gift of choice. Mm-hmm. It's a great gift. And today I want to share with you, and an experiment for the most part for the universe. Today I want to share with you a trial run of Satan now. I tried to focus on our Father and Jesus yesterday, and today will be on Satan and what he has planned for us on this trial run. Count Schwerin von Schwenfeld was a landowner in Germany, a resistance fighter, and an accomplice in the 1940 plot to kill Hitler. After his arrest, he was brought before Roland Freisler, his court. He was the judge. And to humiliate him, just a minute, got to scroll. To humiliate him, he was given ill-fitting clothes with no belt, so that he constantly had to hold his pants up. And the rest that were in the plot that came before him, if they had dentures, the dentures were tossed, so that everyone who came before Freisler came in the most degrading appearance as possible. They stood before what is known as Raving Roland, in as pitiful a state as possible. The mockery of their trials was filmed on newsreel, and Freisler was captured frequently screaming, which was normal for him, at the defendants. Count von Schwenfeld was quickly condemned to death by hanging. Kurt Huber was a professor of philosophy at the University of Munich. A small man, crippled in one foot, plagued with a weak, stammering voice, all from a childhood illness. But one afternoon in 1942, a soldier and former student knocked at his door. The soldier was on home leave and wanted to unburden his soul to his former teacher. He spoke in quiet tones for fear of being overheard by the Nazi neighbors around in Huber's apartment building. He told of the German army's recent attack on the Russians at Stalingrad and how it was becoming the bloodiest battle in Germany, in German history. But worse than this, he spoke of the sterilization experiments that Germany was carrying out on Polish citizens, Polish Jews, I should say, and non-Jews alike. And then, unable to keep himself quiet any longer, he burst out, "Professor Huber, I have something terrible to tell you, and it's not a rumor. I saw it myself. We are shooting Jews in the Crimea. Sir, we are shooting Jews." This was when Huber joined the White Rose, an underground resistance movement, and was later arrested and brought before Freisler in Germany. On July 13, 1943, Huber was executed. Jewish families in France knew that they could send their children for safekeeping to the Huguenots in the mountainous region of Lourdes. The godly, non violent Huguenots housed the children as their own. In an effort to prevent their arrest and deportation across the border to concentration camps in Germany and in Poland, Elise and Johanna were two such children. They were only 11 and 8, scared to be away from their parents, scared to live with strangers, and scared to think of the foreboding future. Their parents, on the other hand, tried to find safety in other families across France, strangers and friends alike. Their parents hid as they could. France was occupied, and it was an appallingly fearful time for all. Julius Schmaling was the commander of the German troops occupying the High Loire area for the few years prior to the end of the war, and he knew of the flow of Jewish children coming into his area. He knew of the underground resistance activity of the quiet residents, but did nothing to stop either. When the war was over, Schmaling was arrested, as were all Germans, on the afternoon of August 23, 1944, while Paris was being liberated. Major Julius Schmaling walked in to the hearing room of the Prefecture in the hands of his enemies. As he walked up the aisle toward the presiding officer of the hearing, something strange started to happen. People in the room, including the tough resistance leader who was chairing the session, rose to their feet. The German officer bowed his head slightly to the resistance officer, and the lean Frenchman bowed back. Then, still standing, the Frenchman delivered himself of a quiet, restraining speech. He spoke of the German services to the people of the Haute-Loire, of their gratitude to him, and of his affectionate personality. Elsewhere in France, Germans were being swiftly tried and executed. North of Le Puy, 55 Germans were mutilated, thrown into a deep well in the suburbs of Saint-Étienne. In a more dangerous part of France than Saint-Étienne, however, the former leader of the Germans, Schmaling, was receiving homage. World War II was a tragic time for the world. We are all aware of this. A new leader quickly changed a peaceful Germany into a monster enemy, one filled with concentration camps, Kristallnacht, Wannsee-type meetings called to solve the Jewish problem. Courts ruling without the restraint of law, secret police, neighbors spying on neighbor, bloody, deadly wars, destroyed, crumbling cities, hunger, starvation, dehumanization, and crying, abandoned children. This was a reality, and it was but a trial run of something far worse to come. We've been told in Daniel 12:1 of a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. Every move by Satan has been directed to one end, to the exaltation of a false Sabbath in the place of the genuine. All the big moves among nations, all the smaller moves in individual lives have had this one ultimate goal in mind, and that's a broad statement to make, but from the 1888 materials, page 477, she says, the position taken by some is that this civil enactment, and that was something going on in the South, I believe, concerning Sunday worship, has no relation to the present observance of the Sabbath. Here again, great blindness is shown to be upon them. In this they are not correct. And here's the key part. For every move from the first made by Satan, and it's an incomplete sentence, you just have to overlook that. Every move from the first made by Satan was the beginning of his work to continue to the end, to exalt the false, to take the place of the genuine Sabbath of Jehovah. So all these movements we've seen over millennium and recently that we are aware of in the 1940s. All of this is directed for one thing, and that's to exalt his Sabbath over God's. Satan orchestrated Hitler and his noxious theories and plans as a practice run to the final solution of his great problem, and in his final round, God's faithful will be targeted for elimination. During the trial run of World War II, the world finally turned against Hitler. It was behind, some of the world was behind him, but finally the world turned against him. And in the last great fight for his life, Satan knows he will have to prevent a similar boomerang reaction of the world against him. And so he will come. Well, let me just back up here. He will come as Christ, speaking words of love and compassion, not the inflammatory rhetoric of Hitler. So let us consider some aspects of Nazism, Satan's trial run, one of his trial runs, that we can expect to be repeated in Satan's final showdown for his life. The first is an illegal court system. In America, we have an appeal process in the judicial system. Laws passed by Congress, for example, can be appealed to the Supreme Court for examination of their constitutionality. And certainly a death decree based on religious belief is unconstitutional. So how could such a decree be attempted in America? In Nazi Germany, the legal system of former days was simply replaced. And not even by new laws, but by the arbitrary decisions of Satan-controlled judges, as we have seen in Freisler and will continue to see. And he was the head of the German court of law. Freisler abandoned all pretense of judicial impartiality. We expect our judges to be impartial. But he abandoned this. He cast off any veneer of judicial dignity, and he remorsefully hectored his hapless defendants. The crimes for which those appearing before the People's Court of Germany ranged from the most serious to the apparently trivial, from assassination attempts on Hitler, to sabotage, to listening to foreign radio broadcasts. For such acts, the accused could be imprisoned, forced into labor, or death. Freisler wrote, and this is an important part, that his court had become a truly revolutionary tribunal to purify the nation. And remember, our nation is going to want to purify itself of us. And its so-called justices used to purify the nation have never been brought to trial. Their crimes remain open and unchallenged on the world's legal records. But most amazing was Freisler's creation of a new crime. It's not new to us today, but back then, a new crime, and that is thought crimes. He said to intend to commit a crime was tantamount to having committed it. It's a deceitful and prejudiced court that purports to know a defendant's thoughts and intent, and then prosecute on that. What happened during this trial run of Satan is important. It shows us, for one, that we cannot depend on our legal system to protect us, thinking that we have a good constitution to fall back upon, or at least an appeal process that usually takes years and will give us time to flee to the mountains and the rocks, etc. With the right person in charge, constitutional law will be swiftly swept aside, just as it was in Nazi Germany. In its place will be the desires of the president and of the judges, and their whims will be inspired and controlled by the arch-deceiver himself. I just want to stop for a minute, and I know there are people who are listening that are not citizens of America, and I'm focusing on America, but you can expect the same thing to happen in your place of residence.
Just same spirit.
That's right. The Nazi People's Court prosecuted and punished people for undermining national defense, for favoring the enemy, revealed by such activities as harboring or socializing with enemy prisoners, giving an enemy a piece of bread to eat, spreading anti-regime propaganda among the people, or even telling a political joke. All of this was prosecuted before Freisler. These new crimes are a precursor of what we can expect in the future. We will be starving, and no one will give us a piece of bread, because it will be again, they will be arrested. They're lying. You'll see. Okay. These crimes are a precursor of what we can expect. For example, when Freisler entered office as president of the People's Court, Hitler's Night and Fog initiative was well underway. Individuals arrested were to be either executed on the spot or secreted away either to Germany for trial under Freisler or to concentration camps. And this is the part I wanted to share with you. A key mandate of the program was that the family and relatives of those kidnapped were to have no knowledge of the cause of the disappearance or of the victim's destination. In short, Night and Fog was to sow terror in the population of the occupied territories. We can also expect to not be told the whereabouts of our loved ones, but perfect love will not allow fear to rule in our lives. Satan seeks to instill terror, but the infinite God holds our hand. At such time, we must trust God to protect our loved ones and to provide for our needs. Ellen White, Volume 9, 17. Fearful tests and trials await the people of God. The spirit of war is stirring the nations from one end of the earth to the other. But in the midst of the time of trouble that is coming, a time of trouble such as not been since there was a nation, that should speak worlds to us. Think of all the trouble we see now. A God's chosen people will stand unmoved. Satan and his host cannot destroy them, for angels that excel in strength will protect them. An important factor in the establishment of the German People's Court was a new law which explicitly empowered the government to enact legislation deviating from the Constitution, think America, and to do so without the sanction of the Reichstag. And so it happened in Germany. Expect our Constitution to be nullified, and not even with the approval of Congress. It happened in Germany, and it will happen in America. For it has to happen. The United States Constitution has to be nullified, made void, or overridden in order for a death decree to be sanctioned. The President of the United States could declare a state of emergency, and our constitutional rights could then be eclipsed. Already the protection of habeas corpus is not applicable under certain circumstances, and I'm going to have to skip the part of habeas corpus. You'll have to read it. We just don't have time. The president can also issue executive orders, presidential directives. On May 9, 2007, for example, President Bush issued a presidential directive that allowed him, quote, to assume control of the federal government following a catastrophic emergency, end quote. It's not spelled out what the emergency would be. We know when we will be living during this time. Emergency after emergency, catastrophic things will be happening. And the president has already issued a directive that he can take control of the federal government, including judicial system. Right now, there are approximately 30 ongoing states of emergency. The law states that if he declares a state of emergency within 6 months, Congress has to rule it either up or down. And it's never happened for any state of emergency. They just remain on the books, giving the president unlimited power. However, an even greater threat is that of being declared an enemy combatant. This can be legally done for people who are not citizens of the U.S., like this Al-Mari. You'll have to read about him. He's a citizen of Qatar. He came over here as a student, was arrested for terroristic activities, and was sentenced, etc. But he was declared, he was brought before the court system as any other defendant would be brought before the court. But one of the president's administrative people asked for him to be for those charges to be dropped, and then he was declared an emergency enemy combatant. Thank you. And if you are declared that, you then have no right to see an attorney, no right to see your family. You're in solitary isolation, and you don't even have to be charged, and you can be kept there for your lifetime unless the prosecution wants to bring something against you. That's true for non-U.S. citizens. However, I want to tell you about the Lackawanna Six. The threat of being labeled an enemy combatant was made to six Arab Americans, soccer players, known as the Lackawanna Six. They were charged with providing aid and support to a terrorist group. What they did was to listen to Muslim clerics preach hatred toward the U.S. while attending camps in Afghanistan, where they were learning about weapons. They hadn't done anything but listen. Okay, let's go on. These six men maintained that once they arrived in Afghanistan, met the people in the camps, they wanted nothing to do with them. But the government told a federal judge that since the clerics had heard the six, since these six had heard the clerics preach violence, the six had committed violence just by listening. The court here in America rejected that argument and said these defendants, they're U.S. citizens, remember, these defendants were entitled to due process of law, as any other citizen would be entitled. But the government lawyers implicitly, not explicitly, but implicitly threatened the six during plea negotiations that if they didn't plead guilty, if they didn't speak up as the government wished, if they didn't cooperate in their own prosecution, not defense, but in their own prosecution, or if they insisted on their due rights, the government would declare them enemy combatants. And if that happened, the six would have no due process of law, no trial, no lawyers, no charges filed against them, and they would receive solitary confinement for life. The attorneys for these six Americans let their clients plead guilty without benefit of trial and accept 6 to 9 year jail terms because they knew it was in their best interest, in spite of the fact that the judge had rejected the prosecution's arguments. Today, all of them have served time, have been released, and are quietly living with their families in the U.S. I mention them because we may be faced... could I interrupt? Would you just give me a warning? I can't see the clock, and I'll forget. Just give me a ding-dong when it's time. Okay, thank you. I mention them because we may be faced with a similar circumstance. We may be offered a plea agreement, a plea deal with a limited sentence instead of life in solitary, if we only admit guilt and deny our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father. While we, with most Americans, are concerned about terrorism and homeland attack, we cannot condone the withholding of the right of habeas corpus and of due process from any American citizen, and we see it as a harbinger of the future for true Seventh-day Adventists. Even greater than these threats to our freedom is the ability of the President of the United States to command the killing of a United States citizen without due process, without charges. The President, and he's done that. The Constitution makes it clear that whenever the government wants the life, liberty, or property of someone, it must follow due process. In other words, it must either sue the person for his property or prosecute him for his life or liberty. And the law, okay, I'm going to just skip that. But in 2011, President Obama ordered the CIA to kill Anwar al-Awlaki. He was in, let me see, I think I have it, what country he was in. Anyway.
Yemen?
Y-E-M-E-N, that's right, thank you. Yemen. And so the CIA did that. He was at a cafe with his son, his son's friends, and the son's friend's father. All of them were citizens, and all of them were killed. The president, and you'll have to read more. I have more documentation on that. And we have to tell you that we're very serious about our documentation. We get at old paths. You know, we have to be careful what we say and what we print. And so what we have there is solid. Okay, now I want to move on. Another important lesson to learn from the Nazi experience is that you cannot always believe official documents. For example, September 1, 1939, Nazi Germany invaded Poland from the west. 16 days later, Soviet Union attacked from the east. They had secretly made an agreement prior to this about doing that. Then the two powers divided the country between them, as agreed in a secret protocol named the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, or otherwise known as the Treaty of Non-Aggression between Germany and so forth. Anyway, however, this later, after they had invaded Poland, they did an official agreement. And in this official agreement, they stated that the government of the German Reich and the government of the USSR considered it exclusively their task, after the disintegration of the Polish state, to reestablish peace and order in these territories, and to assure the peoples, and I'm quoting, to assure the peoples living there a peaceful life in keeping with their national character. They also agreed other things, but that's the important part. After they invaded, they agreed that now things would return to peace after their national character. With these words, the Germans and the Soviets launched a systematic destruction of Poland and its people. They deprived the citizens of the conquered country of all human rights. The attack, and I'm just going to read what they did, because this is living history, because we need to have our minds wrapped around this. You know, we know about Nazism and the killing of the Jews. We know about that, but we think about other things. And I know we can't dwell on these forever, but we need to keep them forefront in our minds, because we are coming to such a day ourselves, and it will take us by surprise unless we are mentally prepared for this. The attack on the civilian population, and physically, I should say, mentally and physically, we need to be prepared. The attack on the civilian population began the moment the Germans crossed into Poland. The bombing of residential districts was as heavy as that of military targets. Low-flying planes cruised over the refugees, machine-gunning down old people, women, and children fleeing from their burning homes. In Warsaw, historical old buildings as well as hospitals clearly marked with a Red Cross were bombing targets. The German Eastern Plan of Reichsführer SS Himmler ordered the extermination of the Polish educated classes, the enslavement of those required for labor, and eventually the deportation of the rest to the east beyond the Ural Mountains. There were many massacres. In the city of Katowice, all the Boy Scouts between the ages of 12 and 17 were rounded up and shot. In the city of Bogoszew and other parts of Pomerania, some 20,000 Poles were shot in reprisal for the deaths of German citizens of Poland who had formed a fifth column and fought against the Polish army at the start of the war. Some 750,000 farmers were forced off their land in the Polish corridor. In all, over 1 million Poles were moved to, it's called General Government, which was a section, a marked off section, where these people lived, and they lived for the purpose of forced labor for the German people. And so the farmers were forced off the land, and over 1 million Poles were moved to this squared off area, and almost as many to Germany, both for forced labor. Most of the educated and professional classes, along with clergy, major landowners, were killed or removed to concentration camps. Those who remained lost all human rights. They were strictly segregated. And I'm reading this so you can get a picture of what we can expect. All Polish schools, churches, cultural institutions were closed. All children over 14, and in some cases as young as 8, were forced to work. Over 1 million German colonists were brought in to settle on confiscated properties. Blonde children who had perfect Teutonic or Germanic features were taken away from their parents and given for adoption to German families, and very few of these children were ever found again. Mass murders were common. And the list goes on. I could list more about just this Polish invasion. Clearly, the peaceful life and the continuation of a national character referred to in this official treaty of friendship, cooperation, etc., was not speaking of Polish people as one would expect, but of the 1 million Germans brought in to live on the confiscated properties. In the midst of the misery of the Polish ghettos was the constant presence of German soldiers. Unmoved by the suffering, they amused themselves with sadism, killing, beating, humiliating their victims. Brutality toward Jews, noted the world-renowned microbiologist Dr. Ludwig Hirschfeld, was a German amusement. And again, most nations would weep to see such misery, but the German soldiers laughed. All the trial runs by Satan in controlling others and perpetuating widespread inhumane atrocities are but precursors. This is what I want you to realize. They're but precursors to his final showdown, in which God's people will be victims of his rage. The events of Nazi Germany occurred under a despot in an otherwise fairly calm world. Soon, in a terribly evil and chaotic world, one filled with numerous bloody uprisings, violent Islamic and radical fundamentalism, financial political chicaneries, abuse of all kinds in families and in workplaces, increasing inner city violence, and out of control natural disasters, Satan will arrive, not as a despot, but as an apparently loving savior. And all the world will wonder after him, and all the world will scour the earth for us as the arch enemy. I can't see the time. What time again do I quit? 10:15? 10:15. Okay. Many heroes worked against Nazism during World War II. Common everyday people risked their lives to help the Jews, the Poles, and men, women, and children of all descents find safety. But there will be no heroes to help us, none. Only the angels of God will protect us, which is all we need. And only upon our true brothers and sisters of faith will we be able to depend, although each will be in anguish over his or her own soul. All other men will hate us, will denounce us, will seek our extermination. Can you understand the counsel to press together in a new light? At this time, probation will have closed and Satan will have gained control of the finally impenitent. Nazi Germany and Nazi-occupied territories pale in intensity of what we can expect. And anyway, entire families in Poland were put to death when caught sheltering Jews. Yet thousands took this risk, whether for days, years, or for a moment. Saving lives was a capital crime. Giving food to the starving was a capital crime. Capital means your life is at stake. Taking in a motherless child was a capital crime. On the other hand, rewards were offered for turning in fugitive Jews and their protectors, while refusal to do so could result in imprisonment or death. Warnings about the automatic death penalty for those who would help Jews in occupied Poland were continually blared out on loudspeakers and posted in countless public places. During the German occupation of wartime Poland, three groups of people lived under the threat of instant death. One group was those made up of resistance fighters. A second group were the fugitive Jews who escaped from the ghettos or who had somehow contrived to avoid going there in the first place. And the third was drawn from the large company of people who had the courage to give succor and support to the resistance, to the Jews, or to both. They were surrounded by informers, and so will we be, recruited by the Gestapo, usually by bribery or blackmail, inside or outside the ghetto. They lived with the knowledge that if caught, the SS would not just shoot them, but their children, their parents, their grandparents as well. The general government, that's that squared off place for laborers, was the only place in occupied Europe where German soldiers and officials were given license to kill without any compunction. The question is, would you capitulate under the threat of the murder of your children or your parents or your grandparents? As a parent and a grandparent, I say emphatically to all children, never do so. No godly parent or grandparent would ever want their child to lose eternal life because of them. Instead, they would demand that you stand firmly for God and trust Him that He will work all things out for yourself and your parents, etc. While God has given the promise that our bread and water will be sure in Isaiah 33:16, He has in times past allowed His people to languish in physical hunger and in thirst, and we can expect this in the future, Great Controversy 6:29. The people of God will not be free of suffering, but while persecuted and distressed, while they endure privation and suffer for want of food, they will not be left to perish. The God who cared for Elijah will not pass by one of His suffering, sacrificing children. He who numbers the hairs of their head will care for them. And in time of famine, they will be satisfied. It doesn't mean you won't be hungry. It doesn't mean you won't be on the point of starvation. But you will be cared for. While the wicked are dying from hunger and pestilence, angels will shield the righteous and supply their need wants, end quote. Isaiah 33:16 also refers to the spiritual needs of the soul. Hungry and thirsty though we may be physically, God will sustain us with spiritual bread and water. No matter what physically we are experiencing, He will sustain us with spiritual bread and water, just as He did Jesus during His wilderness experience. Jesus suffered for want of food in the wilderness to break the hold of appetite on man, yes, but His example can also strengthen us when we are suffering from hunger. We can expect to be cruelly laughed at because of our physical distress, just as the defendants were mocked in Freisler's court. And whether alone or in groups, we will be hungry, perhaps starving, tired, perhaps cold, suffering mental anguish, and perhaps physical disease. And I think of those who are suffering, like, for example, from type 1 diabetes, no insulin is available. We may be suffering physically, but God, at this point of time, will not suffer one of his people to die. There's no purpose in it. It can't serve God's people in the future because there is no future. We are it. Angels have always been our companions and always will be. Our lives, as miserable as they seem, are safely in their hands. The earthliness that longs for relief, that longs for comfort, that longs for preservation of self, even of a godly self, must be consumed. There's something about our earthliness that has to go. When we are content to suffer until God says enough, not when we say enough, when God says enough, we will hear his voice penetrate the deep, dark clouds over us. In the meantime, we must prepare. We must put aside all weights that hinder us. We cannot carry them into heaven. We must now seek a clearer and more integrated understanding of Scripture. No surface readers will pass this test. And we must now give our all to cooperate with heavenly agencies in the perfection of our character. No harbored sin will accompany us through the gates of the New Jerusalem. As Israel entered Canaan, God gave special instruction to them. We find that in Deuteronomy 7. And normally I'd ask you to open, but we must go on. Deuteronomy 7, starting in verse 6, we read, "Thou art and holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are on the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you nor choose you because you were more in number than any people. For ye are the fewest of people." Think of ourselves now. I'll make the application, but as you hear this, think of, we're the fewest of people, but because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto his father, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and God will bring us out with a mighty hand, and not because we're so wonderful, but because he has said he would do it, and he stands by his word. Had brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, from the hand of the president of whatever country you are in. These nations are more than if you should say in your mind, I'm paraphrasing now, these nations are more than I. How can I dispossess them? That's what everyone will be around, this little flock. Thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shalt remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and to all Egypt. Thou shalt not be affrighted of them, for the Lord thy God is among you, a mighty God and terrible, and shall destroy, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction until they be destroyed, and he shall deliver their kings into thy hand, and thou shalt destroy their name from under heaven. There shall no man be able to stand before thee until thou have destroyed them." That's several verses in Deuteronomy 7. Let's consider some vital points. We are to be a holy people unto God, special to him above everyone on the face of the earth. And that will be true just before Jesus comes. He will have a holy people out of the whole world, special unto him. Revelation 14:1 and 5, "And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his father's name written in their foreheads and in their mouth, was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. And I'll skip a great controversy. It's a nice quote. God's people are commanded to be holy. Despite the overwhelming theological stance, we hear today that we will not and cannot be perfect. And I'll read this one from GC 623. Now, while our great high priest is making the atonement for us, we should seek to become perfect in Christ. Not even by a thought could our Savior be brought to yield to the power of temptation. Satan finds in human hearts some point where he can gain a foothold, some sinful desire is cherished by means of which his temptations assert their power. But Christ declared of himself, "The prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me." Satan could find nothing in the Son of God that would enable him to gain the victory. He had kept his Father's commandments, and there was no sin in him that Satan could use to his advantage. This is the condition in which those must be found who shall stand in the time of trouble. We have no choice. We're either here or there.
That's right.
Oh, I said that. We have no choice, brothers and sisters. We either do this by God's grace, or we will receive the wrath of God poured out in the seven last plagues. We cannot accomplish this on our own. However, we must have the mind of Christ, as we read in Philippians 2:5. We must train our minds to think like Christ, just as a musician trains his hands and his feet on the organ. I was thinking of you, Brother Mike. Or his fingers on the violin, and I was thinking of my daughter when I wrote that. And just as the mountain climber trains his body, and I was thinking of Pastor when I wrote that. When the temptation comes to think harshly about someone or negatively about a particular circumstance, swiftly turn your mind to imagine Jesus on the cross or bending over a lifeless body, tenderly calling it back to life. Focus on Jesus. Choose to see him in your mind. Call on him to help you. And the temptation of the moment loses its power always. And Satan will find no advantage in you. You choose, God delivers. Point two, God's people will be the fewest of all people. That's what he said to the Israelites in Deuteronomy, and that will be true for us. There will be few. And you know, I just want to stop. I made a little study on how many leaves are on a big oak tree and how many big oak trees can be in an acre, just to try to imagine if each leaf is a person. There are about 7 billion people on this earth right now. And out of the 7 billion, 144,000 will be standing for God. And that would be, I forget how many acres, but let's just say 20 acres of stately oak trees might be 50 leaves from this tree, 30 leaves from that tree. You wouldn't even miss them looking at that tree if you plucked 50 leaves here and there. And so that's how few there will be of God's people on this earth at the end of time. Brothers and sisters, you are here. You are the little flock. You are God's faithful people. I pray that you are. And when you drive down the road now in West Virginia and you see a hill of trees, hill of beautiful green leaves, just imagine maybe 100 on that hill would represent the few that live for God. So that's the few. Point number three, God will deliver his people from this wicked world with a mighty hand and redeem them out of the house of bondmen and from the land of Pharaoh. Only our deliverance will be from wicked Babylon. If we become afraid of the foes allied against us, who are so much greater in number than we are to remember what God did for the Israelites in Egypt. Remember those things and keep them in your mind, because he will do the same for us. Roland Freisler was an eager and ambitious Nazi. Once a ministerial director of the Prussian Ministry of Justice and later Secretary of State in the Reich Ministry of Justice, he screamed at the defendants in his court, hurled vicious verbal attacks on them, and only a handful walked away with their lives, just a very few. We may be in a similar situation, but we cannot retaliate, even mentally, in like manner. As Freisler, we have to trust our Heavenly Father in Jesus Christ to do all things righteously. And then Genesis 18 and Great Controversy. Huber refused to compromise with Hitler's atrocities. He wrote pamphlets. Remember, he was a professor. He wrote pamphlets against them for the underground to spread far and wide. He was eventually arrested and executed. Schmaling, on the other hand, was content to save a few in his territory. But at the same time, he was comfortable remaining in Hitler's army. He was not motivated by principle, but by convenience. If he looked the other way on the clandestine work of the Huguenots, the French resistance agreed not to attack his soldiers. It was a win-win situation for them. After his release by the French, Schmaling returned to Munich, where he lived in a partially ruined apartment house. I'll skip that. Germany offered him no praise. France was, on the other hand, was appreciative of his efforts and wrote a letter to him, which he carried in his wallet to his dying day. It thanked him for making the conditions of war the best possible under the harsh circumstances, and assured him that the French people remembered him with affection. One of his primary functions at Lourdes was to keep peace, and he accomplished that. But let's not forget that he did this while supporting a nation that perpetuated the murder, torture, and plunder of millions of people. With one hand, Schmaling held to the good he could do in his little community, yes, in the town of Lourdes. But with the other, he clasped the vilest of evil that the world had ever known. We cannot do the same. We can't hold the hand of God and the hand of Satan at the same time. Good will never peacefully coexist with evil. The atrocities worldwide, past and present, the evil machinations of nations, the looming national and international financial crises, the secularization of spirituality, the foundation faltering Adventist church, the deployment of side issues that take time and energy away from the study of God's word, and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans are simply precursors to the last great desperate attempt of Satan to save his own life. He will fail, and he knows it. But what he doesn't know is if you will fail. And he knows if you will fail. So he is after you with a vengeance. For if you do fail, he will not have to suffer for your sins. Even worse to consider, however, is that any failure on our part will cause everlasting pain in the heart of God. May we be faithful. May God have mercy on us, this little flock of his own choosing.
Whence cometh sea bright celestial light? What cause produces this? Up in heaven opens to my sight bright seeds of joy and bliss. O Lord Jehovah, art thou here? These bright proclaims thou art. O him indeed I'm always near. Unto the humble heart. lofty high am displeased, and bless the meek and low. I hear the humble soul that cries, and comfort I bestow upon the trees among the woods. I've chose one little vine. The meek and low are thy to me. The humble heart is mine. Of all the kinds that range at large, I chose one little flock, and those I make my lovely charge. Before them I will walk, and constant shepherd I will be, and all their ways we find, and they shall serve and reverence me. And humble heart is mine.
Thank you, Brother Mike. He's done very well trying to take a quartet song and one person sing it. But the words of the last part, that God has chosen this little flock, and this flock, with humble hearts, they are his, and he will keep you. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus, regardless of what's coming. You know, the disciples of Jesus ignored. They couldn't comprehend what Jesus tried to tell them about his death and the days following that. And they were caught by terrible surprise. And God, in his great mercy, has given us testimony after testimony of what is coming on this earth. And we haven't chosen to be alive at this time. God has chosen us. And let's be faithful to him, is my prayer.